Start. Lowercase, uppercase, it doesn't matter.
I don't think it matters.
Okay. All right. Let me share my browser here. Okay. So what I did this week is I just went through the video, went through the chapter, just pulled out some points that I thought were interesting to discuss. So my slides aren't going to be about everything that was in the section, but just things that I think, or stood out to me. I was also able to do the Hugging Face deployment of the pet classifier. There's a little bit annoying because the example I was using, going off of, I guess from a few years ago, was very like outdated, so it didn't have like version control on the on that main library that it uses for serving these models. So like the whole API had like changed for that library, so the example was like really not working
Oh, the
without.
tutorial that he mentions?
Yeah, so it's
Yeah, that's way out of date. Yeah, I agree.
this one here, the Gradio one. So,
Yeah.
like for
Gradio changed,
instance,
yeah.
like
Yeah.
gr.inputs is no longer works. It has to be gr.image. She just removed the inputs thing,
Yeah.
but the whole like interface library structure changed. So, but I'll just go through some of these key points here, and then I was hoping I could just walk you through what I was able to do with that Gradio thing, and then we could discuss. People could ask
Cool.
questions, share what they did. Yeah, sound okay? All right. So this week we read about deployment. So this is getting so following his philosophy of doing the whole game. He wants you to be successful at actually deploying a model that someone could use, for like a web app experience that someone else could use. It's on the internet, where the model is actually serving predictions for some kind of application. So that was the focus of the week. He has a little bit of a discussion of like what makes a good project and how do you approach a project in a systematic way. He also talks a little bit about cleaning data using models, which I thought was interesting, and maybe some things we could discuss there. And then also just a bunch of points about being familiar how to deploy a model with minimal cost and effort, at least for, experimental phase of a project. So he starts off by talking about starting your project. Some of his main points here were that you should work end to end. So instead of kind of tweaking and trying to make the best possible model or best possible, like hyperparameter tuning and all these things that you can do, but like if you're just starting out, it's better to just get an end to end example going where you're able to actually deploy a working model, serving it, and then by going through that process, you get to see kind of where the hiccups are, where the roadblocks are throughout the whole thing, and then the next time around you can kind of iterate on that. And I think that's very close to the idea of like an MVP that people talk about in like agile development. And I found, at least for my stuff at work, I really like doing this because you also are able to show people what you mean in a finished state, and they get a better idea of what your proposal is for some project or some analysis project if you're able to show them a finished product, or at least a working example. So I think that's on point. He reminds us to experiment after each chapter, which I have just started doing, and I need to do more. And then he also makes a point of like experimenting with known applications when you're starting out. So don't use examples for things where deep learning has not really been explored that much, or it's too much of a transfer from the domains where it's known to be useful. I thought this was an interesting point because I think it makes sense for beginners, but also it kind of goes against some of the stuff you talked about in the first chapter, which is like these are the areas where deep learning has been like innovative, and there's been a lot of like interesting advances. And so you talked about, I think, the first week or first chapter, the idea of like using an image classification model for things that aren't traditionally thought of as images, like you make your time series into an image or something. So I don't know. I guess those two things can be there together, but I thought it was a little bit of a contradiction in a way. Anything else in this section? Anything that stood out to people in the starting your project? Okay. All right. He goes into the drivetrain approach. So this is his own kind of method that he came up with to create projects and modeling projects that are actually targeting some kind of clear outcome. So it starts by defining an objective, like what are you trying to achieve for, if you're a if you're doing it for a product, like what do you want users to be able to do? So the Google example of the Google search, like I want to show users relevant content. And then the next step is like looking at what levers you have control over. So what can you change to help you achieve that objective? What can you modify, tweak in your system that you're doing this project on? And then what data can you collect about those levers? How can you measure that? And then finally, at the very last step, you're like choosing a model that predicts your objective from those levers and other variables. So I like it. I think this is one of the hardest things about analysis projects in general, modeling in general, is like picking the right question and the right objective and not just diving into something because it's like technically interesting. Anyone else have any thoughts on this drivetrain?
I only watched the video and he didn't talk about this in the video.
Okay. So here then it's something new, which is good. It's funny, like I feel like there's some inconsistencies in this course, like between the video, the chapter content, and then the examples. Like it's really hard to like align all of those things. Like I'm expecting like something he references in the video to be linked in the chapter and like be able to find this tutorial that he's actually pulling this code from, and I find it very hard to do that. Sounds like it might not be the only one.
Yeah. Is the drivetrain like something before you do the end-to-end?
I think so. That's my interpretation. Like you want a clear objective and you want to figure out like what levers, what things you can push and pull, like that you have control over to achieve that objective, and then you develop your model. But then, like, yeah, but the interesting question is, like, if you're building like a UI or something, where does that fit into this process? I guess it's probably somewhere in the objective somehow. Maybe it's like, I don't know. I don't have a good answer, but I would think you would start with this before you do any of the UI or any kind of coding or implementation.
Yeah, I think this kind of hits on something that I come across a lot, which like I work with scientists and we usually are not involved with them until after they collect data. So like we don't really have any control on like what data can we collect. As a modeler.
Oh, I see. Yeah, so it's kind of backwards.
Yeah,
I see it also in my job, in terms of like people coming to me with requests. They often will be all the way down here or even on the they're like, I want this analysis or I want this like table or this set of values or something. And then like they don't realize that like maybe if we take three steps back and talk about what you're actually trying to achieve, maybe there's something that I know about the data we have that you might not be aware of that could better address your actual need. So it's hard. I mean, like some people know a lot about data science, data engineering, and maybe they're like someone who can already tell you what they want in that specificity, but other people, you know, may think they know a lot about the data you have, but they don't really. So I don't know. It's hard. Okay. Any other comments on this? There is one section that I'm just skipping over because I think we covered it in the first week pretty well. But let me just show you what I mean. So there's this section on the state of deep learning. And I think Torin, is that right? Sorry if I messed up your name.
No, that's good.
You covered this one last week, I think. So, or at least a similar content. So I think we can. I didn't add anything to my slides about that. Okay. So in data cleaning, I thought two of the so the interesting thing for me was he talks about training your model first, and then kind of going back and looking to see what the observations were with the biggest loss, and using that as a way to detect like incorrect, like basically like there's like validity issues with certain observations potentially, and using this loss kind of filtering as a way to detect them. And he showed an example of like manually removing it. And he said in the video, I think, that this was going to feel weird, or, you know, for people who do data science. But and then I put the point down here that, you know, it kind of makes sense, at least for these image cases, where it's very obvious that like okay, this example is just not an animal, right? It's like a stop sign or something, and I want to remove it. But I feel like if you just do this loss kind of ordering, then you're missing a whole class of problems about like data leakage, for instance, where like the opposite could be true. It could be too good of a prediction, and it could be because you're leaking data from your train set into your test set, or there's some feature that is like is the same signal as the outcome, that, you know, is making it kind of a too trivial of a prediction problem. So yeah, I don't know. I think it might be a little bit specific to the image case potentially. And that's my gut reaction to this guidance, but I don't know. What do you all other?
That's a good point you make. I didn't even think about that. Like, in fact, was he doing this data cleaning just on the training set, or both the training and the validation? I guess I don't remember what he was
doing. Yeah, he did it on both. He did it on the validation also. So
that's a very good point. Yeah, it could easily cause some leaking, or even kind of sort of overfitting in a weird sense. But yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, he was focusing on things that were like clearly out of category, like they just shouldn't have been in the set training set to begin with, or the test or training set to begin with. But I don't know, like how much do you trust yourself to take care of issues that are validity issues, but not like leak in, like drift yourself, you know, into something else that actually may make your model overly optimistic or something like that. So
yeah, this kind of just seems to me like a bad exploratory data analysis. like I guess if you have a lot of data, it's hard to do an EDA, but right. If you don't, you should already have a good sense of the challenges in the data. I don't know, like, and yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
but it kind of, it also reminds me a little bit of like in stat inference, when you do like variance inflation factors and things like that, where you might fit it first and then remove some points later. But I think it's always a best practice to at least report everything, like report it with and without, unless it's clearly a mistake, like what he said in the images, where it's like clearly you're not trying to label a lamp or whatever it was. I don't remember.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I really like your example about BIF. I guess in that case, right, like if you just, I don't know, like, I don't know if an analogous thing would be for like the lamp when you're trying to do animals, but like it almost is like a different kind of type of data or something. And I guess it would be easier to be able to say, hey, this is not numeric, we're going to drop it or something like that.
You know, a counterpoint to that, I would say that, you know, for certain types of, a lot of problems are being used for, and we, I think all of us kind of have a background more in statistical inference or causal inference type things. So we're always thinking about it that way. Whereas here, these type of problems are kind of different often, right? They're kind of intended for just prediction. You know, like McElroy says, right? Prediction, you know, is a different kind of problem. Prediction, you can cheat all you want to. It doesn't really matter as long as the final test said it works, right? You don't care if it's causal or not. It doesn't really matter. Association is all you care about. Non-causal associations make great predictors. So, so I think if from that context, maybe it doesn't matter. You know, feel free to clean any way you want to. Maybe on the test set, you might want to be careful. So you get an honest score of your prediction. You may want to do some kind of hand cleaning then or something. I don't know. So you carefully label the test set, which might be hard, but might be necessary to have people believe what you did. But whatever you did behind the scenes with your validation and training data almost doesn't matter. As long as here's my model and here's some untouched test set that I didn't put my model on and here's how it works, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I guess part of it is what is the model going to be used for in the wild? And are you able to, like, if you do get rid of in some automated way these things that you think are invalid, then can you do that consistently in the wild? And does that fit your use case? And if it does, then I guess there's no problem with it, right? But it was definitely thought provoking, I guess, this section.
Yeah, I mean, that's an observation I have about this book so far. It's a lot of things he hits you with right away that are important. And often, like he says this, I guess, in the beginning, right? He's taking a different approach. He's going to start you kind of at the end. Here's the broad picture of things and things you need to be aware of. Then we'll go into the weeds a little bit. Whereas normally everybody starts like, what's step one? Okay, you know, what's a neural network? Mm-hmm. And you know, we don't even do that really, except for a very high level, right? So
yeah,
interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I do like the whole game idea and this idea of starting with large pre-trained models and fine-tuning them for your application to get early success, because I think he's right that a lot of problems can be solved in that way, and then everything else is going to take more time and crafting, but you know, if you find out that your problem is one of those problems that can be solved in that manner, then it's good to find that out right away.
I agree.
Okay, I'll move on down here. But I guess one thing that he mentioned that just in the section that I didn't cover, this stuff about state of deep learning, that I thought was just a point to raise was this idea of deep learning may not be the best, especially for tabular data, but in any case where you need to, or it's beneficial to combine like multimodal information, like text plus images, or for example, you have to, then you're going to need to use a deep learning kind of model for the most part, or it's really beneficial to use one in that case. So anyway, that was just something that I think we didn't discuss last week, but he brought up in this section. All right, deployment. So, my list didn't work out here, but it's okay. So he talks about the basic process of training a model, exporting the object, the pickled file, in this case, creating a script that loads the model, and then serving those predictions somehow. And the serving part, he mentions Hugging Face with Gradio, which is like a Python library for running a server for any kind of web application, and then GitHub Pages as well. And then I just put a question mark for others because there's a lot out there. Especially if you just want to serve a model, almost every one of these cloud services like Databricks, Azure ML, all these places will allow you to go from a model to an endpoint with the click of a button, and you don't have to manage anything. And you get an endpoint that you can use for inference. So that kind of thing's all over the place today. And I gave this one a shot with Gradio, and I can go over that in a second. Anyone else have anything on this before we go on to the last one? I guess I would love to see if anyone else, after Fran's presentation, if anyone else has tried any of these other options or the same one, Hugging Face. I guess we could talk about that once I go through this. And then this avoiding disaster section, he talks about a bunch of stuff, but I think the two biggest things are, he talks about these warning signs or things to think about after you deploy that could go wrong. So one of them is like, you start to get data that's out of your domain that's not appropriate for the model you trained. And then the other one is like the domain itself could drift over time. And this is a really common thing people talk about in machine learning generally, and ML ops, like making sure that you're not getting like a slowly decreasing performance over time because the distribution of the input is like slowly changing. Okay. Anything on that section? I'll just go into the example that I deployed. Right, I'll just go over there. All right. So I did this classifier example, pet breed classifier. I followed this blog post that was linked on his course in the chapter. Like I mentioned at the beginning, it's published November 16, 2021, and a lot of it doesn't work anymore. So, for instance, gr.inputs is no longer a submodule, and you have to just do gr.image. There's no shape argument in here, stuff like that. But after a little bit of tweaking, I got it to work, and I'll show it here. So, actually had a cat that I saw the other day that I happened to have a picture of for some reason on my computer. This guy, he actually has six toes. And it says he's a Russian blue. And I looked that up, and I don't really think that's right, but it doesn't really look like him. But maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. I guess they can be long-haired.
What's the next class it said?
It says Egyptian Mao. I did. Mao. I mean, maybe it's like, a mix of these two somehow.
A mixed cat.
Yeah. But it doesn't. Maine Coon, I would definitely see. Because of just the long hair. But he's a cute guy though, so and this app doesn't completely work. I had to change one of the arguments, and I think it kind of messed up. Oh no, this doesn't work now. Before it wasn't working. Yeah, that's a Siamese cat for sure. You can also, I thought this is deployment process kind of interesting. They make it really easy to, you just upload this app.py file.
You didn't have any trouble, like you already knew about the LFS thing and all that, because I didn't know. I ran into that, and it caused me a problem because I tried to commit it, and then I followed the instructions on GitHub on do the LFS, and of course I had to roll back because I still had the commitment that committed the comment. I got a comment with the full file in there, so it was kind of a pain. But
yeah,
what's LFS?
So GitHub doesn't let you now has a restriction for putting large files on there directly, as a regular object. So you have to use this large file system thing, LFS. So it's another package you have to install on your computer, get LFS, and then you have to like mark it. So do you tag it as LFS? I already forgot what I did. I went through all the steps I forgot what they were doing.
Yeah.
You have to track it, yeah.
Yeah, what I ended up doing is I did the instructions that were here. Let's see, where is it? There's something that tells you.
Go. Yeah, I didn't actually, I gave up on this tutorial when it didn't work at the beginning. So I went off and get everything on my own. It was in there.
Yeah.
So that part's not on me. That's good. Yeah.
So what I ended up doing, good.
How big is the pickle file? Like how big does it have to be to track?
Let's see, it's 103 megabytes.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, what I had to do is I so they have you like create a new space or whatever, and I create this space for this chapter, and then you clone it locally. But then there's this example that they have where it's like they have the full repo just ready to go for you. So I just clone that also locally and then change the remote, like at the remote reference in Git to like the to my repo. And then basically overwrote everything that I had already had in there and then just pushed it all and it worked. So I just did force to push to the my space with everything that was in the other repo. So, and it worked. But I did have some issues for a while and it was really annoying to figure
What's
out.
Your requirements dot test? So you, is it just fast AI? Yeah, fast AI, okay.
Scikit image, I guess.
I just, the only thing I had to put is fast AI, I guess scikit image might be already.
Yeah. The thing that I was struggling with was the Gradio version. So like I said, the blog post was on a previous, a previous version of Gradio. And like one thing I tried is I tried putting Gradio with a particular version, like locked to a version in here, but it didn't seem to do anything.
Yeah.
So like, I think the runtime or something is like using a certain version of Gradio and I don't know if you can even change it. I haven't really played with it that much, but that was one of the things that I thought was kind of bad. So in the environment management here. But yeah, other than that, it's like pretty simple. So basically you have this interface function and interface function, and then you just have to pass whatever your function is that's going to be served in that interface. And yeah, I guess there's a standard set of arguments to this interface. And
yeah.
It reminds me of Shiny.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good call out. It does. Yeah, it does look a little bit. I mean, it would be interesting to do this kind of thing with Shiny. Try it with Shiny and like PyTorch or something.
Well, there's no reason why you couldn't do it. I mean, one approach would be to do a Shiny app, but then use the API instead, right? Use the Gradio API that it builds for you.
Yeah, they actually mentioned that somewhere down here, I think. Yeah, so you can do a call to the API itself here, predict. And then you get a nice little JSON back. But yeah, that's basically all I have for this week.
Awesome.
Anyone have anything? I don't know. Ron, you talked a lot about your local setup. Is there anything you want to share?
The only thing I would say is it can be a little confusing out there. Like when people talk about what you need, like I'm doing on a DSLC, and people will say, "Oh, you need to have, you need to, you know, you look at YouTube instructions." And they'll say, "Okay, even the fast AI instructions, I'll tell you to go get the NVIDIA SDK or whatever it's called, NVIDIA toolkit. You don't actually need that if you're just using PyTorch with CUDA. That's only if you're going to be like compiling CUDA code, but." These kind of like misinformation. If you go to the Torch website, it doesn't tell you to do that. It just says, hey, you know, use this Ubuntu thing, click the, you can use Conda, you can do this, and gives you what the Conda line you need to pull, right? Then once you've done the Torch, then you can do FastAI right after, and it's no problem. The only other gotcha I had when made my environment, I always started out with Jupyter first because for some reason Jupyter wasn't automatically installing with that NV dev thing. I don't know why that was, but it was a weird issue I had.
So, is there a particular link that you followed for the Torch setup or that?
Yeah, Conda? Just getting there's a Torch called Start Locally. We find it actually.
Okay.
It's got like little buttons you push. Here it is. Get started.
Oh yeah, a little.
Yeah, and you want to use the Linux one, actually, not the Windows one. Like, it doesn't actually matter. They're the same. Cool. I think. Yeah, they're the same. But yeah, you do that Conda install, PyTorch, Torch Vision, blah, 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 CUDA 11. Well, okay. What CUDA version you need to go on your WSL and type in, what is it, NVIDIA? Where's my little thing? I wrote on this.
Wait. Ron, are you sharing this link to everybody?
Oh, I can share like hang on a minute. Sorry, I didn't.
I'll be honest, the system setup and like installing packages, it's kind of still all a mystery to
If
me
you want
for
to, that's if
Python.
you, right. So you can follow those instructions. Actually, if you don't want to, if you don't care about the GPU, you can just skip that and just, you know, just do the fast AI. Oh, another gotcha is that some of the instructions on the video tell you to use a different repo. Now they recommend this repo called, sorry, not a repo, but whatever the conda forge called fast AI instead of, I forget what it was before, fast something else. I don't know. Fast forge or something. Anyway, whatever it was, they don't, that doesn't seem to work anymore. Fast AI is the one to use. But.
And then Fast AI is a wrapper around PyTorch, right?
Right. So it'll install PyTorch for you. If you don't care about GPU, if you want GPU, then you have to first install the right PyTorch. And this is the command NVIDIA SMI you need to use to find out which CUDA version to install, which CUDA version of PyTorch to select in the box. So there's 11.0 or 12.1.
Yeah, I have a Mac, and
So
I'm
for a Mac, you
curious.
can't do it at all.
Oh, you
You
can't?
just have to,
Okay.
you have to use GPU only.
Oh, okay.
It'll work though. It works fine on Mac. I got to install my Mac fast AI, but I just don't use GPU with that. I think Mac, Apple has a special PyTorch, or they used to, or maybe it's the Torch, sorry, the TensorFlow that they had a special. But I think they have their own special Apple. I mean, they want to be on the cutting edge AI, but it's really hard to get these things working on your
Yeah,
PC.
I have an M2 Max on mine. I wonder if I can do that.
Yeah, you
I
find out
have
if
a
something about it
question for
now.
you then, Kevin.
Oh yeah, I haven't tried anything, so I probably won't be helpful, but go ahead. Yeah.
In the video, Jeremy mentioned if you're on a Mac, not to use the Mac's Python and to use Mamba Forge or something.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's saying. I'll be honest, I don't really know much about the whole like system.
Yeah, I think he's just saying like to have Mamba manage your Python installation instead of like using what comes with the system just for compatibility
Yeah, you don't
purposes.
want to mess around with your system Python. It's better to like use, I'm actually using mini conda, but
Oh, how do I know if I'm messing with it or not? I guess it's the question.
Well, if you want to install, you're not messing with them until you start trying to pip install things, then you're messing with it. So you probably don't want to do that in the base whatever environment that the Mac runs, right?
Yeah, Ron, do you use Mamba at all? Or?
I use conda.
Oh, okay.
I kind of wish I was using Mamba because it is supposedly faster, but I've already got a lot of conda investment on my computer. I don't want to start over right now today.
And Tori, if you allowed me, I'm a Mac user, and I guarantee to you, never use the Mac Python. You cause a mess with your system. I already did it, and I regret a lot. So I had to reinstall my MacBook. And
Oh, no.
Basically, what you need to do is manage different environments for Python. And you need a little bit more to know how to do that. That's the problem. But for example, I at the and Kevin, you just sorry, I'm not talking a lot today because I got some colds, and every time I start talking, I start coughing. So sorry if I stop. You read the chapter, and I did. I just watched the video as Tori was saying, and I think I lost a lot of things. So I need to retake this lesson and read the chapter also, because individuals he only presents the Python part. All this discussion was very interesting.
Yeah, I always just assumed when I started this that they would be consistent with each other, but yeah, I don't know. It seems like he's updating the notebooks more recently than the videos, which I guess makes sense. But it says that this file I'm looking at was last updated 2 years ago in GitHub, so maybe not. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. Is there anything else, like, as you think about the video or the chapter, that you stood out to you that we didn't talk about, or something you want to try in the next week or the next meeting?
Yeah, I don't know. I already started watching the next video, so Ron will be learning about the math. Now he'll start going in the weeds.
Yay. Hey.
Yeah, I want to
Andrew's doing that one? Yeah.
want to
Where's
do
Andrew today?
I'm not sure.
I want to do the experimentation locally, get that what we were talking about going. And then I would love to do some image classification little thing. Like I was thinking like classifying like baseball stadiums or something. One thing that I'm a baseball fan, and one thing that I've always liked to do is like when you see like just a little snippet of like a shot, a camera shot from a baseball game, like just a little bit of the side railing or something or an outfield wall, trying to guess what stadium it is. So it was always fun for me to do that. It might be a little bit hard to create that data set, but
Yeah. I mean, you can find tons of pictures of
yeah.
stadiums, but to find labeled pictures is. Well, I can
Right.
try
And
to,
like,
yeah.
and I feel like the labeled pictures are going to be kind of boring because it'll just be like an overhead shot of the
Yeah, exactly.
stadium or something. And I'm like, well, that's easy. I don't, if you know baseball or if you've seen any of these stadiums, you're going to have a good guess of what it is. But yeah, I would love to do like maybe, I mean, I guess like his, the what he talks about data augmentation, like doing like zooming in randomly in certain parts of the image to use that in your training set instead of the whole thing. Maybe that actually would create a model that would be useful for, that kind of like smaller view of a stadium.
Sounds
But
like a good experiment for you to try.
yeah, maybe. Yeah, I'll give it a shot and see what happens. But
Well, I was trying to catch up from last week and do the classifier, and I didn't have specific enough searches. So I was trying to do so my favorite animal is a bison, and like it's buffalo is just a colloquial name. So I was trying to do like bison or buffalo, but because it's like American, the ser image searches are like everything was a North American bison that it returned anyway for both categories. So it didn't
Yeah.
really. I think I would have to put like African buffalo or something. Yeah, anyway.
Oops.
Those are good things to try and learn. Those are
Yeah.
lessons.
But yeah, I also saw some of those weird it like bad images because I still use the like shade. The searches that he had, it was like shade and sun. So there was like a buffalo plaid lampshade that got pulled and
That's
like a
funny.
sun for your car, like a shade
Sunshade with a
that had
buffalo on
animals.
it. That's funny.
Yeah,
Yeah,
that's
I
funny.
guess when you get stuff like that, you could see how you would want to do some kind of pre-processing to get rid of those
Oh
out
yeah.
of domain examples, but
I mean, labeled data is always the problem with these things. I mean, I've worked on like and I was telling you I was working on that graph neural network thing. That was for a problem I was doing for someone, and the biggest problem we had there was labeled data. Just trying to find. And so this fine-tuning thing is was something we use there too. Transfer learning, we use there too, but we trained it on a different problem. Like we trained it on reconstructing the graph, and then use that to, or link prediction, and use that trained network then to fine-tune on. The no prediction problem we're really trying to do, but it's fun. But
there's no graph stuff in this book, right?
don't think so.
Yeah, it's an area I don't know much about, but it seems pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah,
your baseball stadium might work.
Mm-hmm.
Take one of those pre-trained ResNet things or something, try it out.
Yeah, the labeling thing, I've been thinking about that with like respect to large language models and some of these vision models and stuff. I don't know, like I think a lot about anomaly detection for work, and that's the classic, like, it's really hard to get labeled data for anomalies.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was doing. I don't want to go into details, but it was essentially adjacent to anomaly detection, where it's like, really hard to find labeled data. I mean, you get a few. You need lots, though. Anecdotes doesn't work, right? You need a lot more. A few
And it's
examples is not what you need.
like really sometimes like domain dependent, and like one person's knowledge, like there isn't a lot of agreement sometimes with between people.
Right. Yeah.
So it's
The
like, oh, is it?
labelers disagree. That's always great.
I back in a while ago, I was in a lab and we were doing like sentiment analysis, and I remember like the data set we were starting with had like terrible iterator agreement, and I was like, well, how are we going to do anything useful here? Like the humans don't agree with each other, but I don't know. I feel like there is some potential for language models to like at least mimic what the average person would label in some cases, but and then like use like a smaller model to like actually predict that label or something. Anything else?
I just a general observation. I mean, some of the frustrations we're having, like for example, with that tutorial he mentioned, or with the fact that the forge, the conda forge is supposed to use is different, or the I'm not even sure that's the right word, conda forge. It's a conda forge is one of those forges, but there's these collections of the packages, right? And or other things I forgot already. It's like last week, remember I posted that thing, like here's how you have to fix this thing. And well, because of DuckDuckGo, is they're using DuckDuckGo instead of Bing, and then DuckDuckGo changed. So it's like it's both frustrating, but on the other hand, I'm like, you just have to accept it because that's real life. Like when you're doing this for real, especially when you start getting into edge cases, you're looking at people's work that they did a while ago and trying to like make it work for you, and then things have moved on. And yeah. So it's good, I guess. Good to practice that frustration and how to get around it.
He has a quote in there somewhere, which is like something about like he says like somewhere, I don't know if it's in the video or in the chapters, but one of the first 2 weeks content, he said like the libraries and the tools will change frequently, and it's like why it's important to learn the underlying process, or he says something like that.
Yeah.
Speaking of the errors, I think on the forum is still active. I think some people are reporting errors there.
Yeah, I looked at that blog post that I used, and I was surprised that like there was no one on there saying like this doesn't work anymore. But it also doesn't have a comment since. Oh, okay. The last comment was 2023. Oh, it does. Someone actually does say the thing that I saw, the problem I
Oh.
had, and they didn't. I didn't see it. Gr.inputs.
Yeah, that's because everybody's doing large language models now. They don't really care about this stuff anymore. Not being facetious, but it does seem like that's all the rage, right? And that's, well, I guess we'll be getting into that. Well, we'll get that in a few weeks, but also in part two, right? More of that stuff.
I know Ron, you saw the link I posted to the Andre, sorry, I forget his last name. Andre Karpathy, the OpenAI
Yeah.
guy. I really do want to go through that. I've been meaning for months now to go through this tutorial, like with code line by line, and to like follow along.
It's good. I did go through those lectures a while ago. They're really
You
good. There's
did.
a pretty active community. He has a Discord that's very, very active, and
Okay.
he's actually on there.
Yeah, when I think of like AI educators, machine learning, deep learning educators, him and Jeremy Howard, the two that like I think are the best, or the ones that like are best at communicating complex topics to broad audiences.
Yeah. He just does it because he loves it. As far as I could tell. He started doing YouTube. It's funny, if you search for him on YouTube, you'll find like old YouTubes of him doing like juggling or something. I forgot what, some kind of like thing he was teaching people how to do. Funny.
Before he was a multi-millionaire.
Yeah. Maybe he took that down, but there was a time then. Somebody pointed out on this Discord, like, hey, I found your old YouTube videos.
Yeah, well, if anyone wants to go through that video again, and or just like I might go through it and just post my thoughts in our channel if I have time.
Which video? Oh, the final one?
The build GPT from scratch.
Yeah. But he's got more than that. He's got this whole series that starts out with like building your own great building your own mic, he calls it micrograd, your own differentiation, auto diff thing. And building up everything from scratch. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So there's like a sequence to it, or...
Yeah.
Okay. So that one I shared is like further down in the sequence.
I think it's almost meant, I don't know if it's meant to be independent or not, to tell you the truth, but it's much newer.
Maybe we can tack it on when we do the NLP chapter.
Yeah, that would be cool. Or even set aside like a week or something for it.
Yeah.
To add a new chapter.
So that one is well, that's a year ago. Where's that? Which one did you post? Now I'm kind of confused. Was it a year ago?
Building GPT from scratch. So when it was 1 year ago, yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's the right one. Yeah. So that is kind of intended to be kind of the end of the whole series, but I think it's also can be treated separately, maybe. Let me see. I'll take a look at it and let you know if I think that's true.
Yeah. Have you all tried, just as we're talking about this, have you tried Torch and R at all? I know there's like a native R library.
No, but I think my student was trying it. They didn't really get it to work. And then they said they're going to try Jax. So we're trying to do some custom, I can't quite remember what he said. Some custom loss for, and that he said the different auto diff was like causing him issues
in Torch.
I think in both, like PyTorch and RTorch.
It can be a little finicky.
Like he wasn't sure how to set it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jax, I've heard some people mention, but it's kind of the new kid on the block, right?
Yeah, it's from Google, so hopefully it's good.
Usually a safe bet for deep learning stuff.
Oh, I remember. Because we were trying to do some like random basis functions, and he was saying he wasn't quite sure how these random functions would go in the auto differentiation. Anyway, project is not very, I mean, they're still in kind of beginning, so I'm still catching up with him.
Yeah. Yeah, one, I guess, sorry, go ahead, Ron. Was it about
the syllabus? That works.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
That includes the last one that you posted. That's the full syllabus.
Oh, there. Sweet. Right. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah.
But it's worth going through. I mean, I did it a few years
that's
ago.
That's a lot of content.
Yeah. There's a lot there. And it's just, he really goes through every little piece of it. But it's kind of the opposite of this book, right? It's the opposite. Mm-hmm. Like he starts with nothing.
The ground up.
Yeah. And starts out by building its own auto diff thing. And and then, of course, he at the end he abandons that and uses the real one. But
cool. Thank you. Yeah, thanks for sharing that. What I was going to say about like just this conversation made me think about the coding in this book, and like I feel a little bit uneasy about completely relying on the fast AI library. Like I feel like it'll get me going and then I'll want to do just like some basic thing on top of it and then it won't be able to, and then I'm going to have to start from PyTorch and then relearn like an interface to that package, and like I'm just going to be frustrated. And I'm just kind of thinking of like is it, should I like try to learn PyTorch or Torch and just start there and try to like make it work as we go through the book? And I don't know, that's just the thought that's going around in my head.
That's an interesting idea. Yeah, I mean, I think the point of FastAI in this book is to get you up and running fast. You don't have to worry about how to write the PyTorch. You know, he showed you the PyTorch training loop can be long. And there's other alternatives to FastAI, like Keras 3.0 is now the, which is the TensorFlow library, is now works with PyTorch, and there's Lightning. I don't even know if FastAI is very popular, to tell you the truth. Maybe
I need like,
correct me if I'm wrong, but
I need like a abstraction like map of like Keras, PyTorch, TensorFlow. Like, and how they all like, because I know some are like Keras is like a higher level thing than TensorFlow, right? And this TensorFlow would be like the lowest level implementation.
Keras is sort of like FastAI to PyTorch is how Keras was to TensorFlow, if you will. Now with the new Keras, they've actually made it work with multiple backends, including PyTorch and I think Jax is another one.
Oh, that's interesting. That seems like a kind of a trend in a lot of like data software. Yeah. Like they're like writing an interface still, and they have like engines that can, that's cool. Maybe I should check out Keras. Oh, you have? Okay.
Long time ago. On homework.
I think
Keras, though, I think go ahead.
I think in chapter 5, he will do the same with PyTorch. So he's going from the wider view to the details, but he will start working with PyTorch in chapter 5.
Oh, that is very good to know. Yeah. I need to look ahead. Yeah. Well, if he does that, then
that's
maybe
cool,
my anxiety is lessened a little bit about that. Because like, I just feel like, I don't know, like if I'm going to make something eventually for work, right, I'm not going to like probably use FastAI's library for that. I don't know. Just, I mean, maybe
you
I
won't.
Could.
I mean, I wouldn't recommend
I probably
it.
Won't. Yeah.
Cool. Well, thanks, Kevin.
Yeah, good job.